stuff that dreams are made of.
In the world of rugby league in 2015, it was all about timing.
Ryan Hall wins it for Leeds!
Apparently, every minute mattered. It's just that some mattered a whole lot more than others.
It's Turner who puts the foot down! They've only gone and done it again!
For some players, it was time to say goodbye.
And Wellers with another!
For others, it was only just beginning.
That has set the cherry and whites alight!
And when the clock stopped on the 2015 season, it was perfect timing for the Leeds Rhinos.
And Leeds win the treble!
Coming up, we'll be looking back on the last 12 months with those who were right in the thick of it.
I think I said at the time it was like meerkats. Just pop their heads up and think, hold on, we can smell something here.
From the top to the bottom of Super League and an England series win too.
The skipper has won it for England!
Welcome to Headingley, where silver polish is high on the Christmas list. All the major prizes are spending the winter months here after the Leeds Rhinos swept the board in 2015.
I think being at a club like Leeds, it'd be silly to not go for everything. Yet we'd like to get everything. When you set some goals and ambitions, you've got to make them realistic and you've got to make them achievable. And rather than saying, right, let's do it all next year, you know, you're probably better off saying, let's make sure that we start the season off really strongly.
We needed to start well, and we certainly did that. And that's our philosophy at our club. It's bound for success.
Here comes Callum Watkins, and still going, and Gessler's there, Maguire again, to scoot away and score.
2014, the season before, finished in a really, really disappointing way for us, you know, with the euphoria of winning the Challenge Cup and the first time the club had done that for a number of years. We effectively lost our last five league games last year, including the first round of playoffs, and pretty much got kicked out of the playoffs by Catalans, and that was a really, really disappointing flat end to the 2014 season. So we adapted and adjusted. We just spent more time at work to win all three trophies last year. It wasn't luck. It wasn't, didn't that work out nice? You know, it wasn't a case of that. It was through hard work and through a lot of sacrifices.
Now, the former England Rugby League captain, Kevin Sinfield, says switching codes really excites him. He's leaving Leeds Rhinos at the end of the Super League season to join Union side Yorkshire Carnegie.
There's been an announcement on the future of rugby league great Jamie Peacock.
What has been announced today is that he's going to be appointed as the head of rugby at Hull Kingston Rovers.
The Leeds Rhinos forward Kylie Luluai has confirmed he will retire at the end of the 2015 rugby league season.
I've been there all my career at the same time. All three of them have been there. In my first day of, you know, first team training, Kev was in, you know, pre-season training with me as well. So he kind of, from the first day, he was showing me, you know, the way to go and how to handle things. So they've been, you know, there for me every step of the way. I've really cherished the things that they've taught me along the way.
Here comes Peacock. Peacock puts the foot down. Jamie Peacock! Oh, my word! Where did that come from? Jamie Peacock doesn't score tries like that, does he?
There was a point in the season where everybody started talking about, well, you know, we got a chance here, you know, let's see if we can do the treble. And wouldn't it be nice? Wouldn't it be nice for those three? And every time I heard that, I deflected it, tried to defuse it, made mentions to the players a couple of times, you know, we're in it for everybody here. We're not here just for three people. And, you know, Kevin, Kylie and JP were of that sentiment as well. You know, they disassociate themselves from anything to do with, we've got to do it for them. And that was the right thing to do because, you know, you get too emotional, you go into games with the wrong focus. You need to be good defensively, and you want to win because it's good to win.
Five Wembley tries for Tom Briscoe.
Unbelievable! What a feeling! I'd give all them five away just for the win today, but words can't describe how happy that feels.
The emotion of the Challenge Cup final, you know, it takes a lot out of you as Wembley, and obviously going straight into a huge Super 8s game where it's just playoff mentality. It's, you know, you need to win and get as much points as you can to try and finish at the top.
Physically we were tired, but I'd seen enough in 2015 to know that if we just one or two things can go our way, we got the armoury, we got the strike, we got the game in us to be able to do something really special. But you just needed a bit of an opening, a bit of a break, and we got that.
Three teams start with hope and expectation. Leeds in the box seat. A helicopter in the sky carries the league leader's shield, but what will be its final destination? Leeds settling for second spot. Two.
unless they can produce a miracle themselves.
Walking around the halfway line thinking it's going to be a draw here.
The final set is unfolding and I'm watching the clock tick down. It was 1:05 left and 1:55. And I just leapt over to Chris Plew, my assistant, and said, you know, this is tough, this. You know, you've got to win the Challenge Cup and you pay for it. This is really, really hard to take this.
Huddersfield quite keen now to keep Leeds penned inside their own half.
And I didn't suspect anything. And I thought, you know, Magsy was just going to kick long or come up with something. And even when he kicked and chipped, I thought, yeah, OK.
Burrow down that blind side. Maguire, little chip over the top, pricks his across. He's missed it! Ryan Hall has picked it up! Ryan Hall will run away! And with a hooter sounding in the background, Ryan Hall wins it for Leeds in the most dramatic circumstances!
Ryan Hall. You should have seen him run as I've never seen him run as fast as he could there.
It was a brilliant moment. You don't get many of them.
And within that 15-second period, I tell you, the whole landscape of our season changed. Within that 15-second period, I think I said at the time it was like meerkats. Just pop their heads up and think, hold on, we can smell something here. And that was a bit of a meerkat moment for us, where when Ollie did that, I think that was more significant than just winning that one game. That.
To get that win, that gave us a huge boost. You know, going into the week after where we had to challenge a huge Saints team.
And then when we're into the grand final against Wigan, they were favourites. They're the young, fresh, tough team.
We started very well, and even though they scored first, we had a little bit of that momentum.
Hardacre trying to push his way through, gets the ball away to Jordan. Found a way.
We know what Wigan are about. We know the quality they've got. They got themselves back into it and took the lead. You know, we couldn't get much of the ball, but when we did, we defended well to give ourselves that opportunity, and we just got that try in the second half to put the end to it.
It's going to be a score for Walters! Josh Walters is over!
At times, winning grand finals is not just about field position and about possession. It's not about tactics. Sometimes it's about something else. And I thought those three retiring probably helped us. In actually the grand final, I thought that's what got us over the line to a large degree.
Leeds take a hold and Leeds win the treble! What a way to finish a magical season!
You know, I've been here since 1994, been a part of this club, and it's tough going. It's certainly sad, but it's exciting as well. But I couldn't have dreamt to finish like this.
Relief, you know, again, it's a weird emotion that you'd think it'd be euphoria, wouldn't you? You'd think you'd go, yes, we've done it. And there was a bit of that. But had we been so close and to make the grand final after getting league leaders and the Challenge Cup, to have not won the grand final, I'd have got over it by now, but it would have been a huge shame. Just on the field, you start to look around at some of the faces, and those three, Kylie, JP and Kev, you know, everybody likes a fairy tale or a romantic finish, don't they? Everybody does, and you look back at them, and I would look at them from a distance thinking, this must be great for them. To be sent out on such a high, on such a high level of performance, must be brilliant for them.
It's Leeds, Leeds, Leeds!
Well, joining me here at Headingley is Jamie Peacock. Jamie, has it sunk in quite what you guys managed to achieve in 2015?
Yeah, it has a little bit now. I think now the dust has settled and I'm away from the place, and I've had time to reflect on what an achievement it was from the team. I thought it's just because the competition's so tough to try to do it, and what we did was unbelievable. I think we've carved our names into the history within this city, so it's been an unbelievable effort.
And an incredible last couple of months for everybody involved.
Yeah, I think that just added to it. I think we didn't do it the easy way to win the treble. I think we nailed our performance at Wembley against Hull KR, but then emotionally it just took a lot out of us the 3 weeks after, but we recovered, and then had I've used boxing analogy, 3 12th-round knockouts. We were down on points and come up with the goods in the 12th round, and to win that way in sport's incredible.
And when you were here in that semi-final and Kevin kicked the 40-20, what did you think?
That game was ever so emotional for me here at Edinburgh, because I knew it could be my last game, and I didn't want it to be my last game, because if it were, it'd be a losing one at Edinburgh. I didn't want that. And for him to kick that 40-20 just got turned the momentum of the game. We were under pressure. Saints had been camped on our line for a long time, and to come up with a piece of skill like that under that level of pressure is just that what sums Kev up.
We knew from a little way out that yourself, Kylie, Kevin were retiring. At what point do you think that started to drive the team forward?
Not until near the end, right near the end of the season, if we're being honest. It wasn't even spoken about, really, and I think the lads, you could just see probably the will in the eye in the last couple of games, and as much as they wanted to win for themselves as well. But I think, especially when we had to dig in the grand final, you could see it there. You don't hold a team out like we're gonna, like we did in that last 15 minutes, with having some desire to do something incredible, and also the will to want it to do it for somebody else. So I've probably felt it then more than anything. Not throughout the season. The season's too long to be thinking about that.
Do you think, given the structure of the competition as it is now, that another team can do the treble? How tough is that going to be?
I won't say no, but I think you've hit the nail on the head there with the word tough. I think it's going to be incredibly tough. I think you've got other calls above and beyond just wanting to win the treble to do the treble. I know when it's been done before, especially when I was at the Bulls, we wanted to send Jimmy out in the best possible way. And I think at the end, where you need something above and beyond winning the treble, the lads kind of dug in that grand final. So maybe if they get a few blokes retiring at the end of the year at a club, and you play with a great club with a great coach and a great management behind it, you've got a chance. But I think it will be a difficult feat.
Well, it wasn't just about team honours for the Leeds Rhinos. At the end of the season, their fullback, Zach Hardacre, was named Super League's Man of Steel. An incredible year for Zach. What do you think's been the difference for him this year?
I think players grow up as they get older, and they're in a good environment, and he's in a good one with Brian Mack as the coach and some of the senior players. And I think he was in a few last chance saloons, and he got in the last chance saloon, and he delivered. And he's had an amazing year. He was a great person for me to play alongside. Always enthusiastic and always wanted to win, always wanted the ball in his hands when the game was tough and difficult, and a true competitor. So I'm delighted he had the year that he had, a top man.
So is Zach defensively the best fullback out there, do you think?
There's not a better defensive fullback than him in the game at the moment. That's you can't say it's the strongest part of his game, because he's that good at attacking with the ball as well. He's got that strength and that evasiveness that good fullbacks have, but I think his defence, and he just don't want to concede tries, and you don't get many fullbacks that are like that, who don't want to concede tries or want to save tries, and he sees that as one of his top of his priority.
With so much experience having left the club, I mean, he's still a young man, but he's played a lot of games. He is going to be one of the more experienced players, isn't he, next year? How do you think he'll respond to that?
I think he's got a lot of attributes to become a leader, and I think the one he needs to strengthen most is his own discipline and self-discipline. And I think as that progresses and grows in strength, then he'll develop into a fine leader with great experience, and I think he'll be key to the future success of the Rhinos.
So 2015 will be remembered emphatically as the year of the Rhinos. Everybody else will be playing catch-up in 2016. Wigan were unbeatable at the DW Stadium in 2015, and in George Williams had the Young Player of the Year.
Sliding through, George Williams!
It was a little bit of a shock. I was just happy to be shortlisted, but to win it was a massive achievement and something I'm proud of. Quite a few lads my age have made a name for themselves, so to win it was massive.
Matty Bowen and Joe Burgess played their final games for the club as the Warriors came within seconds of claiming the league leader's shield. They made it back to the grand final, but for the second year in a row, it was defeat for Sean Wayne's team at Old Trafford.
Gutted, really. We didn't start very well, and Leeds blew us away at first, but we came back strong, I thought we were going to win with 15 minutes to go, but it was a great final. I've watched it back a few times, but it went to be.
Paul Anderson went through every emotion in charge of the Huddersfield Giants, for whom Jermaine McGilvery enjoyed a stellar season. 27 tries made him Super League's top scorer.
Couldn't have wished for any more. You'd asked me at the start of the year, would I have a year like this? I'd have said no way, but, you know, things are falling into place for me, and, you know, I've matured as a player, and and played a lot better than I have in previous years and improved greatly. I'm not one to really look at my tries. I'm more of a yardage player. I look at how many carries I'm doing, if they're effective and stuff like that. Things that help my team.
The Giants were the form team in the Super 8 stage, winning 5 of their 7 matches. But a heavy semi-final defeat at Wigan left the Giants stranded once again.
It was just that final hurdle in the end that we couldn't get over. It's the same thing again. It's not good enough. We come against the big teams in the big games and we completely fold. I'm like 27 years old now and these guys who are probably about 25, 26 who have played in about 5 or 6 grand finals and stuff like this. I'm 27 years old. I haven't played in one. You know, I just want to win something, whether that be a Challenge Cup or a grand final. I just want a medal or a ring or something like that. They don't just come to you. You could wish and hope all you want. You need to go out there and go grab it.
2014 Super League champions St Helens were hammered 39-0 by South Sydney in the World Club Challenge, but got off to a flyer in defence of their domestic title.
That's a huge pass from Wilkin, and Adam Swift will score.
Paul Wellens played his last game, so too did Lance O'Hire, as Saints used 7 different fullbacks.
It's Quinlan in support for a hat-trick. What an opening night.
We got to 2 semi-finals, didn't we? You know, that doesn't sound too bad, to be honest, but I think from our point of view, internally, I think slightly disappointing, because I think we knew we could have done better and we knew we could have got to those finals and could have probably gone on and won those finals, but at least we got knocked out by the eventual winners, if that makes any difference. But I think, you know, season was okay. It was, you know, generally good, but I think just from our point of view, we probably thought we could do that a little bit better.
Talked about Zach Hardacre, but how good a fullback was Paul Wellens in his game?
Well, for me, Paul Wellens was the best fullback in Super League. Just from his consistency, his will to win, I've spoken about that already. He won't play as a will to win, and he had that in bucket loads. And his bravery, he was an incredibly brave player. I remember that the first time I played alongside him was the 2000 World Cup. I couldn't believe how tough and how brave a player he was. And he'll certainly miss him and miss that drive that he's got and that leadership he's got on it. And off the field as well, what a fantastic man, an absolutely fantastic man. And they're the types of, people that you see the game produce over and over again. You know, very brave on the pitch, but an absolute gentleman off it.
As is Adrian Morley. It somehow seems right that you two are bowing out at the same time.
Yeah, I mean, I have so much respect for Moz. He's a player I've always looked up to. I think he was a pioneer going down to Australia when no British players were there. He took that competition by storm and then came back over here and was absolutely pivotal to the success Warrington had. What toughest player I played against, with or against, but off the field, I mean, his kindness is second to none, and his humility is what makes him the man he is today, and I'm glad to say I played alongside him and I'm his friend as well.
And what about yourself? Has it sunk in yet that you're done?
It's sunk in, and I have no regrets, no nothing. I'm so delighted to have had the career I've had, met the people I've met, and I believe I've been involved with 2 special teams and got to do things I could have never imagined doing. So I'm quite content, quite happy, and who wants to train in this kind of weather? I'm done.
And bowed out in the best possible way.
Yeah, well, incredible. The fairy tale finish, the finish that the 3 of us wanted at Leeds, and the way it actually happened was a fairy tale as well.
So no more game time for Jamie Peacock, but he, like the rest of us, can follow every twist and turn of 2016 on the BBC. We've moved to Keighley, where in May they had to come to terms with the sudden death of halfback Danny Jones. He suffered a cardiac arrest during a game in London and died aged just 29. He left behind a wife, Lizzie, and five-month-old twins, Bobby and Phoebe. The rugby league community rallied round and have raised more than £250,000 to help the family. To say thank you, Lizzie sang Abide With Me ahead of the Challenge Cup final. Lizzie joins me now. Lizzie, when you look back to May and such an awful time for you and the family, and what was it like in terms of everybody in rugby league rallying around you?
It was amazing. Rugby league as a family have been the most wonderful support that I could have asked for. I genuinely don't feel like there would be another support that would come from any other sport in the world. Rugby league are a wonderful, wonderful family.
And in fact, taking you back to the Challenge Cup final, what are your memories of singing Abide With Me?
Magical memories, just crazy to be able to have done what I did. So honoured to be asked to do that, and so wonderful to keep Danny's memory alive, but also to spread the message that, you know, people need to be checked. And I want to keep that message going, and I want to keep singing and keep making people remember Danny, but also make them think, you know, we need to look after ourselves and make sure we're safe and we're healthy.
So how's that campaign going? Because I know it was really important to you that something good came out of Danny's death.
Yeah, definitely. I don't want Danny to have died in vain. And the campaigning's going fantastic. Everybody's really getting behind me. The RFL have been amazing with that, and things are happening all the time. Defibrillators, I see it everywhere. I get messages, I get Facebook, Twitter, I get everything coming through about people that have been saved, about campaigning, about money being raised so we can have a defibrillator in our amateur league club. Yeah, and it's just so lovely to see, and I hope it keeps going.
So how are you doing, and how are Bobby and Phoebe?
They're good. Well, Bobby's been a bit poorly, but he's on the mend, just keeping them in out of the cold. But generally, we're doing okay. We're busy, which is nice, and we've got a wonderful support round us.
Rugby league reached a whole new level at the end of the season when a group of former players and supporters climbed Kilimanjaro. Their aim to play the highest ever game of rugby league, and it was all inspired by the late Steve Prescott. Amongst the group was Becky Meehan.
Hakuna Matata!
Hakuna Matata!
It's not easy, but the opportunity to test ourselves, knowing what Steve was like, because for the last 7 or 8 years of his life, he pushed his body to the limits. So, you know, it's just a shame knowing that he wanted to do this, that he can't be here, because he would be leading the pack.
After 3 days of walking and within 24 hours of the crater, the effort is starting to take its toll on us all, including Warrington Wolves legend Lee Breers.
You'll get there tomorrow.
I'm determined to.
I will.
Paul, do you want to take me back up here? So if I don't do it, I'm not doing it.
The bank, mate, well done.
Give them it.
I never thought it would be like this. I just thought it would be tough. And I'm used to tough things. I like tough things, but I'm all over the place. And I'm doing my best not to cry now. So, yeah.
It's hard.
Yeah, it is. And I know when Big Chris gets up, we'll all be really pleased for him.
Oh, God, we'll be off again.
Yeah. I know.
We have to get some tissues.
I know, it's awful.
All right, let's get a cup of tea.
Cup of ginger tea, I think,
ginger
Becky.
Ginger tea.
Oh, is he the big fella?
Come on! Yay!
Well, it's 4 o'clock in the morning and this is Summit Day, the day that we've been looking forward to with some trepidation, I think it's fair to say. But this is the day that we're going to head for the summit, hopefully get there in about 10 hours' time, and then play rugby in the crater of Kilimanjaro. Let's see how it goes.
As the sun rises, we start to lose members of the party to altitude sickness.
Better you walk off than you carry on. Right, good man.
Finally, Gilman's Point. On the rim of the crater of Kilimanjaro, 5,685 metres above sea level, just below the summit.
Come on, everybody! Well done!
For Adrian Morley, this achievement marks the end of a 20-year playing career. And so we head down into the crater of Kilimanjaro to camp overnight. It's so inhospitable here, no one's camped for several years. Tomorrow, we aim to play the highest ever game of rugby league and make the summit. After a night in the crater of Kilimanjaro, we're getting ready for the match.
We'll kick that one. Kick that one, all right?
80 grueling minutes under RFL referee Robert Hicks.
Yeah, man, get it, Nico.
A full, measured, marked-out pitch with inflatable posts in a bid for the world record for the highest ever game of rugby league. Job done. And so, for the last push to the summit.
Yuppie!
But not before we lose another man to crippling altitude sickness. We've made it. Uhuru Peak, the highest point in Africa. Where, as Adrian Morley found out, even the simplest task seems insurmountable.
Makes you feel pretty weird, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does, yeah.
There's been some dark times. It's definitely the hardest thing I've ever done. But we've got 38 group and we've had to pull each other through, and, you know, things like this last a lifetime.
A fantastic effort from everybody involved there. Right, let's catch up with four more teams, the ones that finished right in the middle.
Castleford ended the season in fifth place, but enjoyed some memorable nights against the teams that finished above them.
Roberts to win it! On the hooter for Castleford!
I think it was a season of nearlies, really. We just missed out on the top four, finishing fifth, and I think fifth, many people think that's a good achievement for a Castleford team who was expected to come nearer the bottom than the top, but we knew once we got our combinations going, we knew we'd be a threat, and we was come the middle part of the season. Yeah, just missed out on the four, which was disappointing.
Liam Finn, no mistake, has he edged this one for Castleford.
We like to throw the ball about, we like to play some good attractive rugby, and it's his defence where it comes a bit unstuck. I think we'd scored many points and we just let a few more in. I think we'll be working on that in pre-season, and hopefully them close games can be a bit more comfortable.
Warrington failed to make the Super League semi-finals, but they did score some eye-catching tries. Their season included home and away wins against Leeds.
Kevin Penny, who's on the search and has found a hole to score the opening try.
Just a very inconsistent year. We had injuries, but every team has injuries. You've got to get on with it, and we come like once every month with a big win, and we just couldn't take it on until the week after. Consistency weren't there at all. I think it's something we're going to have to really work on this year.
Richie Milo, Joel Monaghan and Roy Asatasi have left the club. It'll be a new-look Warrington in 2016.
We've got to build, and we've got a good few signings coming in next year, and they'll bring a lot to us.
Catalan's 10th Super League season was much like many that had gone before it. The Dragons lost just twice at home, but won only twice away.
I think overall we had a disappointing season. We set ourselves some goals at the start of the year and wanted to finish in the top four before we split to the Super 8, which didn't happen. I think, once again, as away form wasn't the best. I think if we could turn that around then we'd have had a better season and hopefully push for that top four, but like I said, we didn't do that.
Todd Carney started just 12 games for the club, though Zeb Tyre was named in the Super League Dream Team.
Well, don't they love the moments?
Todd's a class player, he's a world-class player, and when he plays, we're a different team, as you probably have seen. He controls the game a lot better for us, and we're a miles better team when he plays, and we got a lot more wins when he were in the team.
Hull FC recovered from an Easter derby defeat to avoid the qualifiers. Their mid-season form included 7 wins from 9.
Oh, terrific from Ellis. Real power. What a pass. Lyman goes for the corner. Lyman for the try. Hull FC with just seconds on the clock. This is drop goal territory. And Mark Steen is going to win the game with that kick.
The Black and Whites are aiming high in 2016 with Frank Pritchard among their new recruits.
Goals for myself is to help the team move forward, securing a spot in the top four, and most of all, just being an older head in the team, just giving guidance to the younger boys as well, so giving that extra knowledge, yeah, to the younger boys in the team.
Life here in Salford is rarely dull, but they did avoid the drama of the £1 million game. That fell to Bradford and Wakefield, and the Wildcats secured their Super League status in dramatic fashion. Their legendary coach, Brian Smith, loved it so much, he's come back for more.
I came back because I loved it. I came back because Wakefield asked me to. I felt comfortable all the time I was here. It was pressure and at times nerve-wracking, but I don't think there was a day where I didn't enjoy myself. And certainly, you know, in this environment of pre-season training, it's easy for me to walk in and lead the way here when everybody's ready to, you know, to rumble. We start work at 6 or 6.30 and we finish about 3 and we're doing it 6 days a week. So there's an enormous amount of work going on in our place and we know we have to do that. We're starting from a position, you know, no other team has had to make up as much ground as we've got to make up. So there's no two ways about it. We've got to work our way back into being a real force in the Super League.
It's about a 5 o'clock alarm clock, but Brian's pretty good, he knows what he's doing, so he's getting us all in, playing and stuff. He's got all the knowledge in the world, and if we can take all that from him, should put us in good stead.
Wakefield took the long route to Super League survival in 2015, victorious in the winner-takes-all £1 million game at Bellevue.
Overall, it was a very, very tough season with a lot of disappointments in it. Then it finished on a real high, and a lot of the misfortune that the club had suffered throughout the course of the year all of a sudden turned into fortune.
Moore, made away through, missed the winner, Scott Moore for the line, Scott Moore has just scored a £1 million try. Wakefield, by the skin of the teeth, hang on to their Super League lives.
I played in a couple of Grand Finals and Challenge Cup Finals, but probably this has been the most pressure game I've ever played in. Fighting for people's jobs and mortgages and stuff, so it's been a tough week, but obviously, you can see the revelation everyone's made, everyone's made up.
It was a tremendous amount of courage and commitment from the guys that were left standing. There were some wonderful friendships forged in the pressure of those situations at the back end of last year and team mateship. Those guys care about our club, and then we've been able to add some other guys from outside our club. I definitely feel that they've got the necessary characteristics and talents that'll balance our team out into a much, much more formidable team than we were last season.
The teams that are in that bottom four last year have got a taste of it and probably don't want to be there again this year, so, you know, everyone's fighting to get in the top eight. We've got a pretty big squad here, so the competition will be fierce and hopefully that can bring the right results on the field.
I'm joined by the Director of Rugby League here at Salford, Tim Sheens. Tim, what brought the likes of yourself and Brian Smith to the lower reaches of Super League?
Oh, please. well, probably a couple of old guys who are looking to use the years of experience, I suppose. You'd like to think so. Some people might think we're burnt out even, but I'd like to think that there's still plenty of value in the years that we've spent in the game, and for Wakefield with Brian and Salford for me, it's a new lease of life.
So what did you make of the new structure in Super League?
Very interesting, the middle eight concept. Very interesting in its first. I think you'd have to say it was successful, because it certainly kept us on our toes. It kept the crowds coming and people interested in the game right up until the end of the season, when generally half the team, once you've got an eight and the rest aren't there, they lose interest, don't they? The downside, obviously, is that recruitment, and that you take a big risk at that point, because it's a very unusual system here where if you're eliminated, you basically write off just about every contract in the club. Asking people to come when you're not sure of being in Super League is not easy to do. And elevating teams up and down is in the DNA of the English public, isn't it, with football and with league and so on. So I think it's probably brought that interest back, and the clubs that are in Championship have got now a chance to, if they're good enough, to work their way back into Super League.
So you've had quite a big turnover of players again over the winter, some big names leaving like Rangi Chase. Where do you think you're at for this season?
Well, look, in rebuilding stage, there's no doubt, but I think not to the point where we're not confident to make the playoffs. We are very confident to make the top eight. There wasn't much in it this year, between the 12 teams, to be quite honest. And this year, I think with everyone strengthening, there'll be more teams taking more wins off each other. And with 12 teams and eight spots, it's a realistic goal for any team starting in Super League, whether it be Brian and myself with our sides at this end or at the top two or three teams which have been there since Super League started, that anyone could make that top eight.
So is it time for a bit of stability here at Salford and making some headlines out there on the pitch?
The only way you're out of these things is not only coach your way out of it and put together a strong group of people, but also it's the recruitment. So recruitment will be an ongoing thing for the next 3 years. Not only though from the outside in, but recruiting from within our youngsters. We've got quite a number of really good, outstanding youngsters that I believe will feature in Super League over the next 3 years. So, it's a matter though of your staff, your recruitment is the most important thing. That's what your club's built about, is those sort of personalities, and obviously the history of any organisation is part of your structure as well. So we're very keen to drive what was... is the football side of things here and turn it back into a football club.
So that just leaves us two more teams to catch up on. Here's what happened to Widnes and Hull KR.
Rovers beat Wigan and St Helens in the early weeks of the season when Albert Kelly got the fans on their feet.
Picked up though by Albert Kelly, and he's away! And isn't he covering some ground? Adam Swift in hot pursuit, but Kelly's going to go the distance. What a try for Albert Kelly.
There's a lot of pride and passion in the jumper, and you can see by the fans, they turn up in numbers and they're very loud, and it's just up to us boys, to go out there and get some points. I'm loving it at the moment. It's like a wild roller coaster, I'm having a lot of fun and making a lot of memories.
They made it all the way to Wembley in the Challenge Cup, but recovered from a record-breaking defeat to secure their Super League status in style. They won 7 out of 7 in the qualifiers.
Dixon's on his way with the pace and the step. Oh, what a step, what a finish. Kieran Dixon. Short pass at goal.
Vikings season got off to a dramatic start, but Widnes failed to make the top eight. There was an Easter win over Warrington and a home win against Leeds, but the Vikings ended up in second place in the qualifiers.
There was a couple of games that we were a little bit short on. Two wins probably puts us into seventh, maybe even sixth. When you look at the table, we acquitted ourselves pretty well in the qualifiers. Did what we set out to do, which was maintain our Super League status. We did that quite convincingly in the end. It was a completely different feeling and something that will hold us in good stead in the future.
The year ended with a visit from the number one nation, New Zealand. The Kiwis were over for a three-match series against England. So, Tim, England finally managing to win a series, how important do you think that is to them?
Well, obviously you'd have to ask them, but from the outside looking in, they're important. They've been narrowly beaten. They've made the two Four Nations finals here in England when I've coached here in 09 and 11. Missed out on the World Cup by a whisker in the last few minutes, and probably last year in the Four Nations were unlucky against us. So, you know, so close, but yet, you know, so far. But at the end of the day, at home here in England, they are a stronger side, there's no doubt, and getting stronger all the time. Steve's doing a great job, Steve McNamara. So good to see them win at home, and I think the crowds and the game here would have benefited from that.
So how do you see the Four Nations going? Australia obviously had the best part of a year off.
Yes, well, a lot of things can happen, you know. Injury and what sort of a team turns up. People might argue New Zealand were down in numbers in this last series, and they were. We were in last year's Four Nations. This year, though, England didn't have two or three of their key people, and Burgess back, obviously, make a huge difference. So it's too far away to make that decision as to how they'll go or what. But, you know, you'd like to think that English football, with so many of them playing in Australia and the domestic competition here looking strong, that they should field a good team, given, you know, that the injury gods look after them. That's the big thing.
So you, of course, have been replaced by Mal Meninga as Australia coach. How do you see that appointment?
Look, Mal, yeah, there's obviously a lot of controversy over the situation with state football versus test football, but now Mal's a good fit for it, there's no doubt. He's played the game at that level and captained at that level. The state level is in many ways, as high a level. But the test level needs to be lifted in its profile in that country. The state of origin really controls the dominant stage by way of rep footy in Australia. And I've said it for a few years, but unfortunately it's a difficult thing given the press and the amount of hype around that state series in the middle of the year does push the test games down somewhat. However, you know, when you looked at the World Cup here in 13, the level of interest in it by the Australian players, so many of them played for various nations, including Australia here, it is still a pinnacle of football when you put on that test jumper, be it New Zealand, England or Australia. So, you know, I think it's a good fit. Hopefully Australia, who are in a bit of a change mode at the moment, will sort that out and make it a good series, not only this year, but in the World Cup in 17.
Well, next autumn may seem a long way off, but you will be able to follow every twist and turn of the Four Nations right here on the BBC. Before that, the Super League show returns on Monday, the 8th of February, and once again, we will have highlights of every single game throughout the season. Until then, have a very happy Christmas, and we will leave you with some memorable moments from 2015. Goodbye.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were wrecking balls inside my brain. I will scream loud tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song, take back my life song, prove I'm alright song. My power's turned up, starting right now. I'll be strong, I'll play my fight song. And I don't really care if nobody else believes, cause I've still got a lot of fight left in me. No, I've still got a lot of fight left in me.